Hello guys, and welcome to the 9th episode of the Architects3DP MEGA Build.
A big size and industrial quality 3D printer that I'm designing and building step by step from scratch along this series here at Architects3DP.
This project is only being possible thanks to my Patreon supporters that help me keep going month to month,
and the amazing sponsors of the Architects3DP MEGA that you can see on screen. In the last episode, we assembled the two independent extruders of the MEGA
using parts from the best brands like Duet3D, Bontech, E3D Online, Noctua, Sakata3D, and DiamondCNC. Now the moment has finally arrived. We need to put these two extruders somewhere, and this somewhere is the x-axis of the Architects3DP MEGA. So today we're going to start with the assembly of the x-axis, and once we finish with the assembly, we'll install it to the rest of the frame, forming the y-axis of the printer. So it's time to stop talking and start with the build. But before starting, be sure to click here in the subscribe button and to ring that bell to be notified when new cool stuff is uploaded. If you do it, it will help me creating new content and growing the channel to reach more special viewers like you. Alright guys, so once you are subscribed to the channel, make sure you are.
I'm going to show you the design of the x-axis here in Rhino. As you may already know, I initially planned to use the original Hewin Railwell to form the x-axis of the printer, but after some experimentation and watching that the two independent extruders were going to be quite heavy, and the 1100mm distance is quite long, I finally decided to add a 40x40 aluminium profile to the structure, so everything will be more stable. This also gave me this nice flat surface, where the cable chains can rest as you can see here. By the way, did you notice that we can pass exactly two cable chains in parallel on top of the profile? This is not a coincidence, since I designed them to fit perfectly.
As always, you'll get access to all the files from the links down in the description.
Alright, so continuing with the design, as you can see, the x-axis will be composed by the two profiles and the two 3D printed ends that I've designed to host the NEMA 17 stepper motor on each side, running the belts in parallel, one on top of each other. At the other end of the belt is where we'll have the tensioner mechanism. Each of the ends will have a connection for the cable chain coming from the extruder and a connection to run the cables through the y-axis, keeping everything nice and organized. Once everything assembled, we'll screw the x-axis end to the y-axis carriages that I have right here, and we'll keep everything tight and smooth.
Alright guys, so once in real life, out of the magical design in Rhino where everything fits at the chill, this is where we are going to start.
As I showed in the DiamondCNC unboxing video and I explained before, as I wasn't planning to add the aluminium profile for the x-axis and use the Hewin Railwell itself, I ordered the one with the mounting holes on the back, having this nice and clean front view of the axis.
Also, I did order the 40x40 aluminium profile to Sinerges, who has precisely machined all the profiles of the build, but as I plan not to use this profile for this purpose, now I have to make all the mechanization of the profile myself. So let's get into it. My plan is to make holes that pass through the entire aluminium profile, and then use some bolts to mount the Hewin railing in place.
So for that, first step has been to measure the position of each of the 19 holes that will hold the railing in place. The distance needs to be 60mm. Once measured, I've marked the position with a pen, and then I used a broach with a hammer to mark the exact position of the holes.
Once finished, the next step is to make the holes themselves using a vertical drill. And for that we'll go from the thinner drills till we get to the 6mm bit drill, since the bolts we're going to use to mount the railing with are going to be M5 and they need to pass through the 6mm hole.
So for that, we'll spray some lubricant in the affected zone and we'll make the hole all the way through.
We'll need to repeat all this process in all the 19 holes of the profile, and once we have all of them, we'll repeat again the 19 holes using a thicker drill, and then a third time using a 6mm speed drill as we said before. Once done, we'll have something like this, and what I'm making here in this picture is to make some gapping between the sides of the profile using a thicker bit drill, so we'll be able to pass the heads of the screws later on.
After drilling all the holes as I explained and cleaning everything up, this is going to be the result. We'll have to prepare the Hewin railing, the 40x40 aluminium profile with the 19 pass-through holes machined,
and 19 M5 bolts with a length of 30mm.
As you can see, as we machine these thicker holes here, now the heads of the bolts will fit perfectly, so we'll introduce them like so. Then we'll pick up the Hewin railing and we'll screw them to the aluminium profile from the back. Remember the orientation of the railings we commented on the extruders episode. You have to orient them accordingly with the carriages of the extruders. In our case, the arrow will point to the top.
Once said, I'm going to start with the build.
So first we'll put the aluminium profile on top of the Hewin railing and we'll start inserting all the M5 bolts in place like so. Don't put a lot of pressure, just present them in place and check that they engage. it seems like some of them won't engage properly, and maybe that's because our margin of precision while drilling the holes manually. That's why I recommend you a professional company like Synerges to make all the mechanizations of the components. I will let you their links down in the description, by the way, so you can contact them. Definitely there are some holes that are not properly drilled, so what I've done is to make a mark with a pencil to fix them with the drill. As we can see, they are 1, 2 and 3. I'm going to release all the bolts holding the profile in place. Next, I'm going to take my hand drill that costs 20 euros at IKEA, recommended by Ivan Miranda, and I'm going to redo all the holes with the pencil mark using a 6mm bit drill. Once done, clean everything and test if the bolts fit properly now. As you can see, they do, and what I'm going to do now is to fasten all the bolts using the electric screwdriver to make sure all of them have the same pressure.
You have to install all 19 of them, and if I had some gaps when I assembled it, it's because I had to buy more bolts.
Once we are done with the build, the assembly will look as cool as you can see. What we're going to do now is to insert the extruders in the X-axis, sliding the hearing carriages in very carefully. You don't have to remove the plastic protector, just push the protector with the profile. Until it gets completely out like this. As you can see, first extruder installed successfully. Now be very careful and do not slide it out of the profiles, or your carriages probably won't work anymore. I'm going to go for the second extruder now, and I will try to find a better angle. Here we go. Carefully, we'll press the protector with the hewing profile like so, till it gets out completely. And here we go with the second extruder. As you can see, both extruders can move very smoothly. Remember, be careful, do not slide them out of the railing. I'm checking out if there is some tolerance, but nope. The union in between the carriage and the railing is completely solid. That's something that we will never achieve using linear bearings. Look at this, guys. I can't believe this dream build is coming true. Once we have the extruder in place, we'll make some space, since we're going to need this amazing cable chain I've printed in PETG. And I'm going to put it right here. And to fill this cable chain, we will need some cables, no? So here they are. These are all the necessary cables to run the two extruders of the printer. They are going to be installed inside the cable chain, just like so.
Alright, so I'm gonna clean all this mess, and I'm gonna start with the funnest part of the video, guys. Damn it.
We'll place the axis just like so, so we can have a better look of what we'll need to do. We're going to have to weld all these cables coming out of the extruders to the ones we bought and are going to be passed through the cable chains just like so.
The wiring on both extruders will be very similar, but not exactly the same.
Being the difference in this component right here, and is that the infrared leveling sensor is going to be only in one of the extruders, in my case, the left extruder, that is going to need 3 more wires to route.
In total, I'm going to be using for the right extruder 2 6 wires Ethernet cables, 1 with 4 wires, and 2 cables with 2 wires each with a bigger section. For the left extruder, we'll need again 2 6 wires Ethernet cables, this time 2 4 wires cable, and finally a 2 wires cable with a bigger section.
With one of the 6 wire cables, I'll power the 3 Noctua fans, that will use 2 wires each. With the second 6 wire cable, we'll power the nozzle temperature sensor that uses 2 cables and the stepper motor for the extruder that, as you may know, uses 4 cables, making a total of 6. With the 4 wires cable, I'll power the laser filament sensor that will only use 3 of the 4 wires. Finally, the 2 cables coming out of the heater cartridge will be attached to a 2 wire cable with a bigger section. For the right extruder, the wiring will be just the same, but we'll add an extra 4 wire cable that will power the infrared probe mentioned before, having another extra wire that we won't use for now. To start, I'll cut the zip ties we installed in the extruders episode, and we'll separate all the cables to make the connections we mentioned before. Once separated, we'll need to peel all the cables from both parts, I mean from the long cables we bought, as well as the ones coming out of the extruders. I'm going to let you now with a short time lapse of this process. Notice that from the NoctoFans, since we are using the FLX version, we'll have three wires coming out of each of them. For this use case, we'll only need the red and the black, so we can cut the yellow one like so, since we're not going to use it. I'm going to start welding the cables of the fans, so here we have the three pairs of separated black and red cables coming out of the Nocta fans, and from the other side, we have a 6-wire cable that I have separated in groups of two.
At this point, I strongly recommend you to take notes of all the steps you make, since it will be very helpful later on to make the connections of the cables.
As you can see, I've written here in my project's book the pairs of cable I'm going to be welding. E for the extruder fan will be welded black to white and red to red. L1 for layer fan 1 will have black to green and red to blue. Finally, L2 for layer fan 2 will have black to grey and red to yellow. Once clear, I'm going to prepare all the cables using the electric welder and soft tin. And once prepared, I'll insert some thin heat shrink tubing on each of the wires, that we'll use later to protect the connections. Next, we'll weld each of the cables like so, accordingly to the notes we have on our project's book, and once welded, we'll cover each of the connections with heat shrink tubing just like so. Once finished with the 6 wires, we'll insert a thicker heat shrink tubing from the other end of the cable, and we'll put all of them together, passing the cable through the cable chain mount here. Now we'll repeat the same steps with the 4 wires coming from the motor and the 2 wires coming from the temperature sensor in the nozzle. As we did before, we'll prepare the cables using some tin and the electric welder, both from the cables coming out of the extruder as well as the wires coming out of the cable we're going to install. In this case, we did again another wiring diagram. Now for the cables of the motor, we will weld the red with red, black with grey, green with green, and blue with blue. For the temperature sensor, we'll weld red to yellow and black to white. So as we did before, we'll insert thin heat shrink tubing through each of the wires to protect the connections, and once done, start with the weldings, covering the connections with the heat shrink tubing one by one. Alright, so that was the last one for the motor, and now we're going to weld the temperature sensor. Red to yellow and black to white. Now, as we did before, we'll use a thicker heat shrink tubing to put all the cables together just like so. This makes already a total of 12 wires routed and ready to go. Next, I'm going to prepare the 3 cables coming out of the laser filament sensor that I'm going to weld to the 4-wire cable, where I've cut one of them since we are not going to use it for now. As we did before, I'll weld each of the wires and protect the connections with heat shrink tubing, and then use a thicker one to put all of them together. Finally, pass the cable through the cable chain mount, and here we go! Finally, we'll pass also the 2 wires coming out of the heater cartridge, just like so, and we'll weld them to the 2-wire cable with a thicker section as I announced before. Here we have, guys, the left extruder finished and ready to go.
Now you need to follow the same steps again for the right extruder,
that as you can see I have already prepared and I have right here. Finally, we'll need to pass all the cables through the cable chain mount in order just like so. And here we have both of them prepared. The last step will be to replace the zip ties we cut before with new ones, making some cable management. Here we have one extruder, and the second one. Look how cool they look, guys! Please let me know what do you think of the design down below in the comment section, and smash the like button if you like it. What I'm going to do now is, as I said before, to take the cables of the heater cartridge, cut them, and weld them to 2 2-wire thick cables. As always, peel the cables, prepare them with tin, insert the heat shrink tubing, weld the cables, and protect the connections. Now yes, we have finished with all the welding, and we are officially ready to jump to the next step. For that, we'll put the cables more or less straight on each of the sides, since what we're going to do next is to install the 2 3D printed cable chains that I have already assembled and I have right here. Actually, I'm going to divide it in two portions. So that's one and two. So first, I'm going to remove the cable link caps that I have printed in Ambar PETG from Sakata 3D Filaments, and we'll keep the chain link bodies assembled, that I have also printed in black PETG from Sakata 3D. Once we have the black body separated from the caps, I'm going to pass it from below, and I'm going to connect it to the cable chain mount on the extruder body just like so. Next, what we'll need to do is to pull from the cables to let them as straight as possible, and once extended, we'll start closing the links with the Ambar PETG caps one by one, till we complete all the chain. Try to keep the cables organized inside the cable chain to not have problems later on. This is a very slow process, but you need to be patient, since the final result, once you finish, will be insane. Here we go! Here we have, guys, as you can see, one of the cable chains of the extruders completely closed and ready to go. Now, what we're going to do is no other than repeat the same process, for in this case, the left extruder. I'm going to skip this part of the video. And look at what we have here, guys. Both extruders with the cable chains installed and ready to go. The extruders are going to move with the cable chain oriented like this, and this one will be connected to the 3D printed ends of the X-axis, that I have already printed and I have right here. But we're going to assemble them in the next episode, guys, where we'll finish the X-axis, so definitely stay tuned for the next video.
Remember that, as always, you will find all the STL files linked down in the description, where you will also find the link to the Rhino file that I have in progress, as well as the complete bill of materials of the Architects3DP MEGA, where you will find the links to buy all the necessary products that we used in each of the different episodes. Finally, I just wanted to ask you to subscribe to Architects3DP if you still haven't, hit the like button, leave a comment, and share this video so more people will be able to enjoy with this project. And as always, a special shout out to our Patreon supporters for making this channel possible. If you want to join them and support the channel as well, you can do it navigating to patreon.com/architects3dp, clicking here in the top right corner, or in the link in the description. Remember that becoming a Patreon, you will get access to all the necessary components for this project, as well as all the past projects in the channel, and much more rewards that you can check in our Patreon page. Okay guys, so as always, see you in the next video!